Pranay, what about others? Whether they will join the class or not right now?
I don't know, sir. Akila will join. Sorry, Akila's joined, sir. Reminding others, I don't know, sir.
Okay, I shall wait for 5 minutes, then I will start.
Okay, sir. So, what about the previous class link, sir?
Okay, I'm going to start right now. If anybody comes, let them join. Screen is visible to everyone now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. My voice is visible now, Pranya. I mean,
Yes, sir.
audible.
Yes.
Okay. Today we are going to see about the insecticide resistance and insecticide resistant management and some important topics of toxicology. Maybe this will be the last class of toxicology. First we can see about insecticide residue. Insecticide residue, any substance or mixture of substance in food for man or animals after resulting from the use of pesticide are usually called as insecticide residue. This insecticide residue can be controlled. I mean, it can be put into two groups based on their usage. I mean, at which level that residue can be available in food chain or else of body, human body or any other organism body. Based on that, they will have, they are having two terms. One is maximum residue limits, another one is acceptable daily intake or ADI. This maximum residue limit is shortly called as MRL. It is nothing but the pesticide residues on the crops are monitored through use of some limitations, which are based on the analysis of quantity of given chemicals. Remains usually remains on the food products after the harvest of that food. Usually the MRL will be fixed at 0.01 milligram per kilogram for any vegetables or any other food materials. But at present, what we are consuming in brinjal or else okra, bendi, or else some of the vegetable crops, it's having a residual limit more than 50%. That two states like Punjab, Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra is leading in this. Acceptable daily intake or ADI means it's a measure of amount of specific pesticide in food or drinking water that can be ingested on a daily basis over a lifetime without any appreciable health risk. It is nothing but well, how much and up to which level you can take the residues inside your body through your lifetime. That is acceptable daily intake. Every day, how much you are taking. If it crosses above that limit, it will make harm to your body. Usually this ADI is expressed in milligrams per kilogram of body weight per day. You see this two, just expansion. They ask you many times in exam, what is MRI, MRL, what is ADI? Next one is the bio concentration or bioaccumulation and a biomagnification. These two relates with how this residues are accumulating in the body or else magnifying in the food chain. They have, based on that, they have given these two. Bioconcentration or bioaccumulation is the movement of chemical from surrounding medium to organism, from an environment to inside the body. Example, DDT. DDT is lipophilic. It means lipid loving, and it's usually soluble in lipid and accumulates in the fatty tissues of edible fishes and human fatty tissue. Simply, if you in ocean or else any ponds, if it is fish is growing there, if there is any accumulation of chemicals in that pond or in the oceans, petroleum leakages are happening now. At that time, this chemicals will be accumulated into the organism which present on that ecosystem, pond ecosystem or sea ecosystem. So it will lead to bioconcentration or bioaccumulation. In case of biomagnification, it describes the increasing of the concentration of that accumulated chemical in a food chain manner. Usually energy will be transferred from one organism to another organism in the food chain. As the small organisms are eaten by larger ones, the concentration of pesticides and other chemicals also increased or magnified in the tissues of the other organism. Very high concentration can be observed in the topmost predators, including man. For example, an insect is, we are spraying an insecticide over a plant. An insect is eating the plant. That chemical will be accumulated in the insect body, which is eating that plant. That insect is eaten by another one predator. That another one organism, another one insect or any other animal which consumed by any other one predator. Finally, we humans are eating that. For example, we are eating a goat. In this chain, that chemical will be magnifying in every organism, every level of organism. Finally, the topmost predator, we humans, will have the more chemicals. This is the reason why some people are pure vegetarians, but they are getting some carcinogens or tumors in the stomach or lungs and or in the mouth regions. This is the reason. What are the effects due to this bioaccumulation or bioconcentration? Death of the organism will happen. Cancers will take place. Tumors will take place. And some lesions in the efficient animals. Reproductive inhibition. Sterility. Usually, it is most predominant nowadays. Many nowadays in humans, I mean, if you see in India, in the recent past of 10 years, there are more number of fertility hospitals has been increased. The reason because the natural reproductive ability, that capacity is reduced because of high consumption of food materials contaminated with the chemicals, specifically insecticides, and suppression of our immune system. Easily our immune system gets suppressed. So only we can't able to withstand even a normal fever nowadays. And the disruption of hormonal systems. Because of this hormonal disruption, many reversals, sex reversal in human beings also nowadays becoming very abruptly it's seen. And DNA damage and cellular level damage, inheritance, it may leads to mutation of our DNA. And the teratogenic effect, it leads to physical deformities in beaks of birds. And the DDT, why it is banned? Because of the high residual effect of DDT over the eggs of eagle, a group of eagle in USA. The eggs of eagle got deformed shell. So once the eagle lays the egg, it will break very soon. So the population in a period, in a decade, 10 years, that total population of the eagle getting reduced. It is a national bird of USA too. So in this has been inquired and investigated by Rachel Carson and given in the book called Silent Spring, which was published in the year 1960. So based on that, the DDT has been banned in 1970s in USA and followed by all the other countries in the following years. And as well as intergenerational effects, effects are not apparent until in subsequent generation of organisms takes place. Next is the insecticide resistance. Insecticide resistance is the decreased susceptibility of a pest population to a specific group of insecticide that was previously effective in controlling that specific pest. And this insecticide resistance is of two types. One is multiple resistance, another one is cross resistance. This multiple resistance is the phenomenon in which the pest is resistant to more than one class of pesticides. This can happen in one pesticide. I mean, this can happen if one pesticide is used continuously and it becomes resistant, we will go for another one pesticide, and after that also will become resistant. So the insect will be resistant to multiple group of insecticides. So it is called multiple resistance. In case of cross resistance, wait a minute. Hello. Hello. Charita, tell me. Pranaya.
Hello.
Pranaya, is it audible?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Nah, it's audible only, no?
Yes, sir. My signal is poor, sir.
So okay. In case of cross resistance, actually it occurs.
Hello. अकेला सर वेलफेयर आ
हाँ आते कल सड़न गई तो
अबे अबे
जॉइन होता रहा मालूम
मैं भी छोड़ा ले वेट चाह ले बैंक सत्ता नो चरिता ना माय सर
प्राणिया प्लीज वेट अ मिनट प्लीज प्लीज वेट अ मिनट प्राणिया 1 मिनट ओनली now we can continue. Actually, in this cross resistance, an insect will be resistant to one particular group of insecticide. That also will be resistant to the related group of insecticide with the same mode of action. It is cross resistance. I mean, multiple resistance, it is different. An insect will be resistant to more group of insecticide because of the continuous using of that insecticide for a longer time. That is multiple resistance. Another one is cross resistance. You can see here the photos.
So once again, explain the cross resistance, sir.
Cross resistance. Ah, okay. See, for example, imidacloprid, an insecticide is there. An insect sucking pest like leafhopper, BPH is there. I am spraying imidacloprid over this BPH control for 3 years continuously. That BPH will be for creating the resistance to imidacloprid now. Now what you are doing means again you are changing the imidacloprid into acetamiprid, the insecticide which belongs to the same neonicotinoid group, acetamiprid, that also having same mode of action. Here now also even you are spraying very first time also BPH will also resistant to that insecticide. This is called cross resistance. A phenomenon which occurs when the genetic mutation, because of the mutation takes place in the insect body, made the pest resistant to one pesticide. But also makes it resistant to other pesticides, especially one with similar mechanism of action. So it is called cross resistance. Resistant for one insecticide brings resistant to related insecticide. This is cross resistance. Now you are able to understand?
Yes, sir.
You can see the photo here. While first you are here, some sucking pest is there. You are spraying insecticide continuously for first time. More number of insects will be died. But if you are spraying this continuously for many years without any insecticide rotation or without properly maintaining any waiting period, there will be creation of resistance. So insect population will be, death will be very less only. So it is called insect resistance, a simple photographic representation. Next one is the mechanism of resistance. How insects are making this resistant mechanism? It is, for your level, it is not that much required, but I am taking. Maybe in exams, if they ask, you can aware now. Actually, insecticide mechanism of two types. One is post-adaptive mechanism. Another one is pre-adaptive mechanism. Pre-adaptive mechanism is the genetic mechanism. Genetically, insect will have some genes which will be resistant to particular insecticide. That is pre-adaptive mechanism. First, we will see the post-adaptive mechanism. Post-adaptive mechanism is nothing but it will convert the toxic insecticide chemical into non-toxic nature by means of metabolization. Either it will convert into a non-toxic metabolite or excretory excretion, or else it will make as a dietary factor, or it may store that in the body in a non-toxic form. In this post-adaptive mechanism, one specific mechanism is detoxification. In post-adaptive mechanism, one's mechanism is physiological mechanism. In that mechanism called detoxification is there. Detoxification is nothing but while I'm taking mode of action, I have told one, there will be a enzyme called mixed function oxidases, which will be present in the insects to capture the insecticides or any toxic foreign materials, and will change it into a non-toxic metabolite. That will be done here. The resistance to insecticides is due to the ability of insect to detoxify or degrade that insecticide by some enzymes. The detoxifying enzymes being present in larger quantities in resistant insects, and it will be absent or present only in minute quantities in susceptible insects. Some best example of detoxifying enzymes are dehydroxychlorinase. Here enzyme is its chlorinase. What it will do means it will detoxify the organochlorine group of insecticides like DDT to non-toxic form of called a DDE in DDT resistant house flies. If a house fly is there, in that house fly, if you are spraying a DDT, what it will do means it will release an enzyme called a dehydrochlorinase. This dehydrochlorinase will capture the DDT and convert the DDT into DDE. So it won't be toxic to house fly. DDE is not toxic in nature, but DDT is toxic in nature. This is called detoxification. Next one is behavioral mechanism. In behavioral mechanism, there will be alteration of insect behavior or ecology, which helps in resistant, which provides resistance against insecticides. What it will do means it will avoiding of treated areas. If you are spraying insecticide, it is observed that the resistant insect groups, for example, house flies, it tend to become sedentary. Sedentary means it won't move. It will stand in a particular area itself. It won't move at all. And it also do not prefer the insecticide treated surface area for taking rest. So it won't get any effect of insecticide and it won't die also. This is a behavioral mechanism of resistance for insecticides. Other examples are avoidance are seen in the red scale of California, which usually closes its spiracles when hydrogen cyanide concentration becomes more. In case of codling moth, it will show arsenic insecticide resistance, which it usually rejects the first leaf bite, which is treated with arsenial insecticide. It's like this. So many group of insects are resistant towards OP compounds, organochlorine, synthetic pyrethroids, and carbamates. This is a post-adaptive mechanism. Pre-adaptive mechanism, as I told, it's based on genetic mechanism. Here, if you see example, this KDR is nothing but knockdown. This knockdown resistant, KDR is knockdown resistant gene. KDR0, this knockdown resistant gene in chromosome number 3 of housefly will make housefly resistant to DDT. The same KDR NPR gene, KDR NPR gene in the chromosome number 5 of housefly will prevent it from synthetic pyrethroid attacks. And a single dormant resistant gene in chromosome 2 of Drosophila prevent it from it will bring resistance towards DDT and BHC. Gene called DDTase gene, the DDTase based gene based resistance can be easily broken or else it's abolished by a chemical called DMC. Dichloro alpha methyl benzohydrol. You just see this, it's not that much important, but these three are very important. KDR0 in the gene in the chromosome number 3, KDR NPR gene in the chromosome number 5, single dominant resistant gene in the chromosome number 2 of house flies and Drosophila will bring resistance to DDT, pyrethroids, and other groups of insecticides which belongs to organochlorine mostly. Some reports which of insecticides, insect shows resistant towards insecticides. First report of insecticide came from Melander. Melander reported the first insecticide resistance by insect in 1914 by Sanjo scale against lime sulfur. And in 1946, the housefly Musca domestica was reported to be developed resistant to the miracle product DDT. In the exam, they will simply ask, DAS is called miracle product, DDT. DDT is the miracle product. And the pesticide resistance in agriculture pest was first noticed in 1963 in Singara beetle. It is very, very important. Galurisella biramnica in Delhi, it's showed resistance to DDT and BHC. And the next agriculture important pest which showed resistance to pesticides is our tobacco caterpillar Spodoptera litura, the polyphagous pest for BHC in 1965. Among all insects, diamondback moth showed highest number of insecticide resistance. And more number of insects are resistant towards cyclodins and DDT, simply organochlorine group of insecticides. and the maximum resistance is showed by diptheran group of insecticides in the, sorry insects which belongs to order diptera. Now we will go for insecticide resistant management. Insecticide resistant management consists of three methods. First one is moderation. Moderation is nothing but leaving the insecticide treated, I mean insecticide untreated areas in a field. You should not treat an area which is which having susceptible population. It means if 10 plants are there, some 2 plants will be more susceptible to insects. You should not spray insecticides over there, so that a susceptible plant will only attack that plants. So it further it won't show resistant in the other 8 plants which is sprayed with insecticides. And the next one is the saturation. Saturation is nothing but here the high doses of insecticide will be applied along with some synergist to kill that resistant insect population. Some insect will be showing resistant to some insecticide. Now here what they will do means that those insects will be killed by providing more dose of insecticide, but it is not a good way of insect control because it will make more residues in the products as well as in soil. Multiple attack is a method in which there will be you should properly utilize the insecticides mixtures. It means a proper application mixture of other group of pesticides like fungicide, herbicide in a proper dosage, and there should be a proper sequence of the application. The waiting period should be properly maintained, and a rotation of insecticide should be followed. So these are combination of these things are called multiple attack. So these are the insecticide resistant management tactics, I mean methods. Next one is insect resurgence. Insect resurgence is nothing but it's an abnormal increase in the pest population resulting after an insecticide application. Usually it far exceeds the economic injury level. Before that, I will first we can see the secondary outbreak. Secondary outbreak is because of the use of broad spectrum insecticides, it kills a large number of insects other than the target insects also. It means the natural enemies also will be killed here. This reduces the competitive pressure among the existing species. So the minor pest won't have any predator for control. So it will become major here. How the whitefly became a major pest in cotton is because of this secondary outbreak only. There is once in a time there will be high spray use of synthetic pyrethroids. So it leads to killing of natural enemies in the cotton ecosystem. Whitefly population become increased more in the later days nowadays. And then in case of resurgence, the maximum case of resurgence of insects usually seen in Homoptera. Nearly 44% of resurgence has been shown by Homoptera only, like BPH, DLH, all hoppers every in many plants, and followed by some mite groups, polyphagous mites, like nearly 26%, and the Lepidopteran group shows nearly 24%. You can see a photo here. In this pest A, this is pest A you are seeing is a pest A. Next one is pest B. This is a small ones are pest B. This pest A is a major pest, this pest B is a minor pest, and this is natural enemies. Your black color you are seeing is a natural enemy. What you are means you are spraying an insecticide. The secondary pest are created when a pesticide applied to control a pest also kills the high proportion of natural enemies. Because of your spraying insecticide here, not only the major pest dies but also the natural enemies. There is no natural enemy here. So pest B population is more here. So this pest B now becomes a major pest. So this is called secondary outbreak. Yeah, see here photo. In this also you can see insecticide is sprayed here. Here pest A, some major pest is there, minor pest is there, as well as some natural enemies also there. Here major pest are died along with natural enemies also. So minor pest only survives. This minor pest now become a major one. Population becomes increased here. Some reports related to insecticide resistance and secondary outbreak. The first report of pest resistance was induced by insecticides was seen in a red spider mite on cotton with the high usage of DDT.
Sir,
tell me.
What is insect resurgence, sir?
Resurgence is nothing but backing up. ஃபார் எக்ஸாம்பிள் இஃப் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் பிபிஹெச் 10 பிபிஹெச் பாப்புலேஷன் இஸ் தேர் இன்செக்ட்ஸ் ஆர் தேர் ஐ எம் ஸ்ப்ரேயிங் அண்ட் இன்செக்டிசைட் இம்ப்ராக்ளோபேட் நவ் சிந்தட்டிக் பெரித்ராய்ட் ஐ வில் ஸ்ப்ரே இன் சிந்தட்டிக் பெரித்ராய்ட் நவ் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் தட் 10 பாப்புலேஷன் டைஸ் பட் ஒன்ஸ் தட் இன்செக்ட்ஸ் கெப்பாசிட்டி பிகம் ரெடியூசஸ் ஃபர்தர் இந்த நெக்ஸ்ட் ஜென்ரேஷன் த பாப்புலேஷன் வில் பி இன்க்ரீஸ் டபுள் டைம்ஸ் தென் த இயர்லியர் ஒன் ஸோ இட் வில் ரீச் த எக்கனாமிக் இன்ஜுரி வெரி சூன் இட் வில் எக்ஸீட் த எக்கனாமிக் இன்ஜுரி இட் செல்ஃப் ஸோ இட்ஸ் வெரி டஃப் டு கண்ட்ரோல் தட் இன்செக்ட் அட் த டைம் இட் இஸ் கால்ட் ரிசர்ஜன்ஸ் ஐ மீன் ஃபிளேக்கிங் அ பேக் இட்ஸ் த பாப்புலேஷன் இன்க்ரீசஸ் வெரி சூன் இன் த அப்கமிங் ஜென்ரேஷன் பிகாஸ் ஆஃப் தட் ரெடியூஸ்ட் ஆக்டிவிட்டி ஆஃப் இன்செக்டிசைட் பை மீன்ஸ் ஆஃப் ரெசிஸ்டன்ஸ் பை இன்செக்ட்ஸ் தட் இஸ் கால்ட் ரிசர்ஜன்ஸ் அப்நார்மல் இன்க்ரீஸ் சிம்பிளி யூ கேன் ரிமெம்பர் த பாயிண்ட் அப்நார்மல் இன்க்ரீஸ் இன் த பெஸ்ட் பாப்புலேஷன் resulting from insecticide application. Now you able to understand?
Yes, sir.
Just to remember the difference between secondary outbreak and resurgence, that's all. In secondary outbreak, minor will become major. In resurgence, there will be abnormal increase of pest population than the earlier infestation. That is the difference, that's all. See, here in this diagram, This is for secondary outbreak, okay? Major, minor becoming major. This is for pest resurgence. Once, while it is insect population is more here, you are spraying insecticide. Then at that time, insects, nearly 99% of insects are died here. Only two are there. Further in the next generation, their population becomes further more. Suddenly it will increase double times than the earlier one. Because of the insects that resistance also created by insects. This is pest resurgence, abnormal increase. The first report by red spider mite on cotton against DDT 1970. And the maximum report of insect resurgence has been seen in plant hoppers, the two brown plant hopper for rice. There are more BPH biotypes out there. Because of its resurgence, more BPH biotypes has been developed. BPH first in earlier 1950s, it's a minor one, but after that it becomes a major pest in of rice because of the extensive use of insecticides. Now we can see some important research institutes related with toxicology. First one is the International Institute of Biotechnology and Toxicology, IIBTA. It is located in Padappai in Chennai, Tamil Nadu. Next one is the Indian Institute of Toxicology, which is located at Pune. And a very important one is the National Institute of Plant Health Management, located at Hyderabad. Either this NIPHM or else NBAR or else this International Institute of Biotechnology and Toxicology or else Central Insects Laboratory. Among this, one will be asked in an exam in ICR. Central Insects Laboratory is located at Faridabad. And the Institute of Pesticide Formulation and Technology, IFFT, is located at Haryana. That's all. You can ask your doubts right now.
Please upload yesterday's link, sir.
So just now, before I'm going for class, I spoke with the admin to send the links of previous classes in the group. They told they will send, or else I itself will see and send you how to send the previous class link.
Okay.
PDF. Tell me. Tell me, Nikhila.
Send the PPT to yesterday's PPT.
Okay. Yesterday's and today I will make it as a combined material and I will send you in group. Okay. Charita, are you having any doubt?
No, sir.
Okay. I think so. Toxicology portion maximum I have covered, except that equipments that we will cover in IPM portion. The IPM portion you can cover insecticide spray equipments, sprayers, testers, formulation of insecticides. These groups, everything we can cover there. Mostly from history on toxicology history until the mechanism, this resistance mechanism, residue, insecticide residue. Their management, everything we have covered in this. So if you are getting any doubts, you can ask after my class over also. Thank you. I will wind up the class right now.